Hi, friends in Christ, all around our community. We are delighted that we are able to communicate with you and connect with you via this video and on TV. This is a great way of worshiping while you're still at home. We're also very happy that we can connect with people in person. Now, in our sanctuary, we've been taking some precautions. We're asking people to wear masks, and most people do. We're happy about that. We also have space set aside with pews roped off in the sanctuary to give people that social distancing that's important, that physical distancing. But we also recognize, listening to people, that there is a need for a service that is maybe even safer than that. And so we are looking to add a service to our schedule where masks will be required. If you don't like that, again, we have the option of worshiping at home, and we have some flexibility at our other services. But on Saturday the 5th, we will be holding a service at 3 p.m. We expect it to be a smaller crowd. That's an unusual time, I know, but it is designed to meet the needs of those who have some health concerns, so masks required. We will offer communion as an option at the very end of that service, and it will be a more traditional type of worship setting. So if that's something you've been looking for, we invite you to join with us on September 5th at 3 o'clock. This will be a first Saturday of the month kind of service, as we see the need for that. So please come and check it out if that's something that appeals to you. Otherwise, we do have our regular services on Saturdays at 5:30 and Sundays at 8 and at 10:30. Again, we're glad that we can connect with you right now via this video. So God be with you and bless you.
Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart.
We are gathered this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. And one of the ways that God transforms our mind, our heart, is through confession and forgiveness. So we have that opportunity to do that. And so let us confess our sin to God, our merciful Father. Gracious God, with contrition and repentance, we admit and confess our sinfulness. We are by nature sinful and unclean. Daily we have sinned and done things we ought not to have done, and have not done that which we are to have done as your servants. We indeed deserve your punishment in this life and for eternity. Trusting in your mercy, we come to you for forgiveness. Our trust is not in ourselves, but in the merits of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us, O God. Grant us remission of all our sins, and by the power of the Holy Spirit at work within our hearts and lives, lead us into ways that reflect your goodness and love. And the simple but powerful and beautiful good news: Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son, Jesus, to die for you and for me, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
And our readings for today begins in the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 51. Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness, you who seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but that I might bless him and multiply him. For the Lord comforts Zion. He comforts all her waste places, and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Give attention to me, my people, and give ear to me, my nation, for a law will go out from me, and I will set my justice before a light to the peoples. My righteousness draws near, my salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples. The coastlands hope for me, and for my arm they wait. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens vanish like smoke, and the earth will wear out like a garment, and they who dwell in it will die in like manner. But my salvation will be forever, and my righteousness will never be dismayed. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from Romans, the 11th and 12th chapters. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God! How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways! For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body of Christ, and individually members one of another. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them, if prophecy, in proportion to our faith, if service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. And the one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our holy gospel is from Matthew, the 16th chapter. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he strictly charged the disciples to tell no one that he was the Christ. The gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. This reading for the sermon text today from Isaiah has so much packed into it, and I'm very excited today to meditate on it with all of you. And it really gives us three main instructions as readers and listeners. Isaiah, and of course it's also God, tells us today in the reading to first look back, to look to our past, to second also look around, look to the here and now and the present, and then thirdly to look forward, to look to the future and to the age to come. But before we dive more into that, let's first take a moment in a word of prayer. Let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight today, O Lord, especially as we learn how you call us to look upon you in every trouble, and also as we hear that we have a true identity and a true purpose in you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, while I was growing up back at home in Iowa, we always had this old rectangular picture frame that was placed up at the top of our stairs, right at the top of the landing as you would go upstairs to the upstairs bedrooms. And I would go past this picture basically every day, probably multiple times a day. In fact, and without ceasing, almost every time I would just take a quick glance at this picture frame. And just to give you more information, this picture frame did not just have one picture in it, though. It actually had about a dozen pictures inside of it. And in between these pictures, there is this dullish, almost dusty, greenish, army gray-looking color. And some of these pictures were all different sizes. Some were circles, some were rectangles or squares, or some were even this weird oval-shaped that could only fit a face and shoulders. But all these pictures had one thing in common, and that was they were black and white and very, very old. And now, it's not the old comparing me, millennial me, old, you know, with how young I am. It's more like this is an old that makes everyone still feel young, even the oldest and wisest people. Because these pictures were not only from the 1900s, they were from the 1800s. And so, every day, without fail, I would walk by this picture frame. And these pictures, and I would just glance at them. I hardly knew anything about them, really. I didn't know where they were taken at or who was actually even in the pictures. But I did know why the pictures were up there. And that's because my parents had told me that these were my past relatives, my old, old, old family members. That's all I knew. Some weird people who had some weird outfits on, who also had some weird facial hair, guys with very long beards, and also everyone in the pictures were not smiling, as was the case for many old, old pictures. But they were family, and they were my history, and somehow were a part of my family's story. And then, sometime in my high school years, I asked my grandma, who was visiting one time, to explain to me who all of these people were in this old, weird family picture and picture frame we had. And then everything changed. You see, she began to explain to me about who all of these people were, and also where these pictures were taken. See, my grandma is kind of like the family tree expert or the family tree nerd for us. She knew all about our family's history, and then she gave some of this history and passed it on to me. She gave me more pieces to my family's history. And from that point forward, all these pictures had new meaning for me. No longer were they just some random family members from a long time ago that I knew nothing about. And now, in my high schooler mind at least, these people were no longer weird or looked weird or dressed weird, but they were kind of cool, and it kind of gave me a satisfaction to know who they were in relation to me. And so now, let's look back at the beginning of this text from Isaiah. The very first thing that God does is he tells Israel, he asks Israel to look back, to look to their past. He says, from Isaiah, "Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you." Now, when he asks them to look back and remember Abraham and Sarah, these two people were not just like some old dusty photograph of some random people with a dull green background that doesn't have any meaning. No, they weren't two people who Israel just walked past every day and also people who they thought were weird. Instead, remembering Abraham and Sarah, who were their past relatives and parents, aroused a story in the minds of the Israelites. It helped them to remember their history and to remember who they really were. It reminds them of their story, and their story and their family history gave them meaning. And even modern psychology would agree with this today. There are many studies to show that parents can raise or increase their child's confidence or well-being by simply more often sharing stories about their family history, past family members, or even past important family events. For kids and adults alike, but especially children, knowing more about their history and knowing more about someone's own history and past helps you remember who you are and whose you are. It helps you fit more into your family story, and therefore you have meaning. And this is one of the many reasons why so many children who don't know their birth parents often work so hard, and they search and search for answers both about their parents and about their past. This is also one of the many reasons why ancestry websites and ancestry testing have gotten so popular as of late. Now that the technology in the field of DNA and genetics is more advanced, people want to know more about their ancestry, more about who they are, more about who their ancestors are, or what their genes are made up of, or where they came from. And this is all because knowing your story and knowing your family history gives you an identity. It gives you meaning. And this is exactly why God tells Israel and also tells us to look back at our past. And what is our past? What is our history? What even is our story as Christians? Our past is that we, as Christians, are part of something so much bigger than any one person or even one person's entire lifetime. We are part of an amazing group of people that is almost as timeless as history itself. We are part of the one true holy Christian church that has extended all the way from now, all the way through Martin Luther in the time of the Reformation, all the way through that, even to the very first and early Christian church, all the way to the apostles, all the way to Jesus. But it doesn't even end there. It also extends all the way through the Old Testament to Abraham and Sarah, whom God called. And you might even say it extends all the way to Adam and Eve. But it's because of Jesus' death and resurrection 2,000 years ago that we have an incredible meaning as people who are created, called, and loved by God. Plain and simple, our story is that we have an identity as being a precious child of God through one faith and one baptism. But God doesn't end there. As we go back to the Isaiah reading again, we see that God then instructs Israel and instructs us to do the second most important thing, and that is to look to the present, to look to the here and now. He says again, "Pay attention to me. My righteousness draws near. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will judge the peoples." God is essentially saying right there, hey, look what I am doing right now. And many things that God is doing right now has been fulfilled in Jesus. So for today, God is telling us to look to Jesus, who is our salvation, who is our judge, and who gives us righteousness. God also tells us that here in the now, in the present, he is in charge of the nations of the world, and he gives justice to them. We don't know how that exactly looks or how that comes about, but he does, nevertheless, promise it. And lastly, God says that here and now he gives us his law, which is another fancy word for his word and his promises. And we are to continue to look to those words and promises to guide our day-to-day lives. And so it is in Jesus and in his word that we can find meaning in our lives right now. We also have an identity to be sharers and proclaimers of that word to other people, to our neighbors. And while the world around us seems to be in tatters and chaos many times, there is order and meaning in God's word. And we get to tell others about this amazing meaning and purpose that they have in God. Sadly, most of the time, it is also here and now in the present where we also get distracted or lost from this meaning, purpose, or identity that we have. This happens in two huge ways. Number one, we just simply lose touch with our identity and the meaning we have, because in today's world, we are told, and even under a lot of pressure, to find our identity in many other things. One of these examples is to maybe find your identity in the things that you buy or the things that you own. And while, of course, many people probably don't directly think that they find meaning in their life from the things they own, materialism still does creep slowly into our lives. I mean, we do live in America, which is the king and queen of having lots and lots and lots of stuff. For example, how often do we define or talk about someone based on how much money or stuff they have, or even based on how much stuff or money they don't have? We might even talk about, you know, someone lives on the nice side of town or the poor side of town, or somebody that lives on the right side of the train tracks or the wrong side of the train tracks, or even if someone lives on Lakeside, Lake Hickory side, or someone who doesn't live on the lake. We might even talk about money and stuff so much in these terms that we let stuff and money start to define how we think about ourselves and how we think about others. Or another example, after the huge and sad, devastating storms that moved through Iowa and other parts of the Midwest about a week and a half ago, many people began to realize just how much stuff they took for granted, like simple things like electricity that we use so much, or having a lot of nice farm machinery, or lots of nice farm equipment, or even having the best-looking kitchen or kitchen appliances, or even just having a nice decorated home. We just expect to have the comfort that we think we deserve, and until it is taken away from us, we don't really become truly thankful for the things that matter. Or we just want to buy more and more things, like a new toy or a new gadget, new Xbox, new phone, new game system, whatever you might say, or even a new home decoration or kitchen appliance, all the while forgetting that these things are in fact temporary until literally a storm comes and destroys it all away from us. And well, for Israel, they got so upset by their captivity because they were taken away from their homeland. They were taken away from their homes. They lost their animals, their possessions, their crops. They even lost their temple, their physical place of worship, and their way of life. They got so upset because they forgot about how God's promises for them exist outside of physical and material things. And we also so easily follow other identities or try to find meaning from other things. Or might I say, we might even chase after idols. So much so that we need to be called back to our roots. We need to be called back to God, to his word and promises for us. And so number two, the second way we get lost is that we get distracted from what God is doing right now in our lives. We have so many distractions in life, so many things that Satan might put in our path, or so many things that our sinful self runs after and chases after. Honestly, our life sometimes could be described as the dog named Doug from the movie called Up. Him and his friends in the movie Up are many times just walking down a path. Everything is going along nicely when all of a sudden he thinks he hears or sees a squirrel. He says, "Squirrel," and then he just gets distracted. And many times in our Christian lives, we are walking along just fine, living under God's grace and remembering that we have an identity as being a child of God, when all of a sudden, squirrel, we get distracted and then we start running after something that can get us in deep trouble. Sometimes we might get so caught up in the politics of election season. We might get so focused on other people and their political views. We worry about how others might vote or even how I should vote myself. Or we get annoyed with people who stay too quiet and silent on pressing current events or hot topics. Or maybe the opposite, we get annoyed with people who are too loud and too public with their political views day after day. Maybe we become so angry and irate just scrolling through our social media feeds. Or maybe we get distracted with all the coronavirus news. And it might kind of sound like a broken record, but we can suddenly become filled with only an overwhelming fear of getting sick. Or we lose patience with a family member or a close friend who is kind of disrespectful about the topic, so much so that we slander or gossip or talk bad behind their backs about them. Or maybe we just become so focused on protecting me, myself, and I that we forget about our neighbor down the street who really is very alone and is in a lot of need. I mean, honestly, with all this 2020 doomsday talk, why not just start to feel sorry for ourselves? I mean, why not think, I have a right to focus on my own comfort in this horrible, horrible year, right? Well, it all boils down to the same thing. All of these things cause us to take our eyes off of God. Instead of looking at what God is doing and what he promises and what he keeps on doing in our life, we look to others, or we look inside of ourselves, or we only become focused on our own fears and desires, so much so that we lose our sight and we don't look to our hope or who our faith is in. So again, God calls us back to our roots, to look at Jesus. God instructs us to look at our history and to look at our Christian family story, to look at his words and his promises here and now, and also to look forward. And this leads us to the third and final thing that this text from Isaiah tells us and instructs us to do. God lastly instructs us to look forward to the future, to the age to come. He is telling us to look forward to heaven, and it is there, in heaven, where lasting comfort comes. In heaven, we have a place to look at with hope, a place to look at with excitement, and a place to look at with joy. We have a joy in heaven that cannot be crushed, no matter what the year 2020 does try to throw at us. We have a joy that we get to experience with just a small taste in Holy Communion. And we also have a joy that we could get to experience here and now, worshiping with other saints and believers. Because in that moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the final trumpet sound, all the distractions, all the pandemics, all the wrong places that we turn to or even look to, all the storms, all the sins that we commit in our life, even the earth as we know it, will, as Isaiah says, wear out like a garment. But on that day, in that place of heaven, our salvation will be forever, and our righteousness will never be dismayed. Thanks be to God for that. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
All right, so Apostles' Creed and Prayers, take one. Now that we've had the opportunity to hear God's word proclaimed, we have the chance to profess the Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. We now have the opportunity to come before the Lord God Almighty, in whom we have just professed our faith, to put that faith into action by praying to him. Lord God, it is a joy to be able to worship in your name as one body in Christ Jesus. Lord, we have people all across this region, and we thank you that we are able to join our hearts together at this time to come before you with our prayer, with our praise, with our thanksgivings, with our concerns, that we can place all of our cares upon you, Lord. We thank you that you hear our prayer and that you do more than we ask and more than we even imagine. Certainly, Lord, we want to continue to lift up the schools and teachers and administrators all across this region. We lift up families and students, praying your blessing upon them as they try to sort out what is the best education for children and the best way to accomplish that. We pray, Lord, your blessing upon schools as they seek to serve students. And we ask, Lord, that you continue to bless the school we have here at St. Stephen's as an opportunity to minister to these kids day in and day out. We pray, Father, that your blessing also be upon University Christian High School, and we thank you for the partnership we share with them and how your word goes forth all across this county and country, the state, the nation, the world. And we lift up, Lord, Shawan and Krista Trump serving you as missionaries in Africa and Pastor Zhang Yang serving at Trinity Hmong Lutheran Church. Jesus, as we pray for students, we especially want to lift up high school youth and the ministry that we have to them, that they may be encouraged and inspired, that they may be well-discipled, and Lord, that they continue to grow in faith and shine, Lord, with your love. And we ask, Lord, that you protect them in every way, in body, mind, and spirit. Jesus, we also lift up those who serve in our community, who serve us as a nation. We pray especially for Kyle Westby, who has been deployed to Iraq. We ask, Lord, your grace upon him and that you remind him that you're always with him. Let his family do that as well, that they may be encouraged and comforted. Jesus, we pray for those who need healing, for Lori Kirkendall, Lee Maynor, Kevin Huffman, Tammy Gilbert, Ann Graham, Judy Tranium, Carol Huffman, Kathy Kirby, Bob Watson, Pat Walsh, Erica Klein-Moretz, Roger Drum, Grayson Stevens, Renita Buchanan-Cisnero, Fred Wish, Carrie Schwenk, Steve Davis, Brittany Watson. We lift up, Lord, the staff and the residents of Westwood Hills Nursing Facility in Wilkesboro. We pray for Alice Killian, Amber Conley, Bill Klein, and many more that are upon our hearts. We place them before your throne of mercy for your healing hand, your protection, but Lord, also for encouragement and just for your love to be known to each one for whom we pray. Lord, we thank you for the family of faith that we have, and this week we rejoice in the fellowship that we have with John and Kimberly Tuft and family, and Brian and Lauren Weaver and family, and Jeff and Deanna Bogle and family, Ruth Willis and Peggy Allison. Lord, these brothers and sisters in Christ are so dear to you and to us as well. And we pray that this week is especially one that is filled with your light, your hope, your joy. Lord God, thank you also for other people who serve in our community, for our fire department and police department, all the members of the military. We pray, Father, for first responders and medical personnel. Thank you, Lord, for those who serve us. And we ask that they have a sense of accomplishment, a sense of satisfaction in doing their job so well that it is a great blessing to others. Lord God, it is with joy also that we welcome into this family of faith Abigail May, Olivia Sauter, daughter of Matthew and Jessica. And as she is to be baptized, Lord, we just give you thanks for her life and the gift of your Holy Spirit given to her, claiming her as your own child. Lord, it is into your hands that we commend all for whom we pray. We trust in your mercy. We prayed in your strong name, Jesus. We are privileged to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Show you our school. It looks like a regular school on the outside, but is very special on the inside. This is my teacher. And this is my classroom. I love first grade. We learn about math. By my classroom is a computer lab.
This is our library. I love to read books. Let's read one.
Gym.
This is our school gym.
I love playing on the first grade team this year. Someday, I want to play on the varsity basketball team. This is where I eat lunch. I love eating lunch with my friends. My brother is in preschool, and he goes to school with me too.
Recess is one of my favorite parts of the day.
Special, and this is a very special place. This is our chapel. Every Wednesday we meet here and learn about Jesus. This is our pastor.
There are a lot of special people at my school,
like our principal and our secretary.
All the teachers here are so nice and helpful. My favorite part about SSLS, which is our school, well, probably learning about Jesus with my friends and teachers.
Hi, I'm Mr. Charles. I'm the principal at St. Stephen's Lutheran School. And here at St. Stephen's, we're committed to excellence in Christian education. We value relationships with each other and with Christ. And we're committed to excellence. And during this time of the COVID crisis, we have continued that excellence throughout. So we have been doing this for over 75 years. And we are driven by excellence in Christian education.
Come visit us.
Come,
just as you are.